Dear colleagues, as we fortunately have canceled this year's World Congress in Montreal, we thought it would be a good idea to at least share some highlights from the virtual Congress that took place back in February. Before the video starts, I would like to announce that we will open the Symposia submission website in July again for the 2022 World Congress in Taipei, Taiwan. I look forward to seeing you there in person next year. And now please enjoy the video. Oh, and don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel below for free so that you can watch more video in the coming weeks. Thank you.
Be there in person. My name is Joseph Penninger, and I would like to tell you today about our work we have been doing on ACE2, how we discovered it and what actually led to the function of ACE2 and how this became the center of a pandemic. Doing so, we, for instance, created the first systemic map for heart failure based on this flight genetics. So we played on the piano of flight genetics. This was a long time before CRISPR actually existed in our world. So in Vienna, the institute I built and developed, I'm very proud of it becoming one of the prime institutes of the world, the Institute of Molecular Biotechnology of the Academy of Sciences. We developed these technologies that we can basically shut down any gene we wanted using flight genetics. The other thing which interested me at this time, and actually already earlier, was to find pathways which regulate the development of the heart. And this is a fly embryo, a Drosophila embryo, and at the stage 12. And as you can see, so these are actually the cells which then fuse and form this beautiful heart tube of the Drosophila. And at this time, we relied on P element mutant flies, so basically natural mutants. There were around 1,200 around got access in. And the idea was, let's see and find genes which would regulate the development of the heart tube in Drosophila. And this is how it looked. So this is a wild type Drosophila, and these are mutant flies. And as you can see, there are always these two, three cells, which are defined by these markers we call Eve and Tinman, and then they fuse together to form this heart tube. And in the mutants, for instance, in this one, you see some of them are totally missing, so the heart tube basically does not form. So we indeed could find, and this was actually 22 years ago, 23 years ago, when we did this work in 1998, when I was a young researcher at the University of Toronto. This was then I worked at this time 13 years in Toronto, then moved to Vienna, and now actually went back to Canada 2 years ago. And when we identified some of the mutants, we were in for a big surprise, because we realized that Drosophila had actually two copies of a gene which we knew for a long time. And this gene is called ACE, angiotensin converting enzyme. And one of the copies in Drosophila was actually short form. And so Mike Krakow in my laboratory around 1998 cloned ACE2. That's why we called it ACE2, the second ACE, the second angiotensin converting enzyme. It's highly conserved in evolution. As I told you, we can find it back in Drosophila. And of course, we can find it in mice, rats. This is actually what I learned. I'm a functional geneticist, so we made some of the first knockout mice in the world. So I do genetic engineering in stem cells for nearly 20 years now. And so we defined ACE2. A paper all of a sudden came out from Mike Fasan at this time in Harvard, that the SARS virus, by its spike protein, would actually utilize ACE2 for fusion of the virus to the target cells and for viral entry. So Mike claimed that ACE2 could be the receptor for the SARS virus. However, at the same time, there were multiple other receptors postulated, for instance, lectins, other receptors, CD147, for instance. And so the question was, is ACE2 indeed the essential receptor for the SARS coronavirus? Or is it a cell line phenomenon and has no in vivo relevance? Since we had the only knockout mouse in the world on ACE2, we immediately sent our mice to China. That infected our mice with a mouse-adapted SARS coronavirus. And as you can see, in wild-type mice, there's a massive infection. We can recover the virus. There's some pathology, not as severe as in humans, but some lung pathology. And when we knocked out ACE2, there was no recoverable virus and there's no pathology. So this was the essential experiment to show that ACE2 is the critical in vivo receptor for a SARS coronavirus infection. No ACE2, no SARS infection. The other thing we found, which was very interesting, is actually if you infect a mouse with the SARS coronavirus, and then you look for the ACE2 protein in the lung and the heart, it disappeared. So basically what the virus does, it binds to ACE2. This is important to internalize the virus to get into the cells, but at the same time, this also leads to downregulation and disappearance of ACE2, ending up more or less in an animal which is more or less like an ACE2 knockout mouse. So to put this all together, and we published this in 2005, what we discovered is that the renin-angiotensin system is induced by non-infectious, and infectious triggers of lung injury. This leads to the generation of angiotensin II and via the AT1 receptor. This drives severe lung injury, edema formation. It also regulates bradykinin and bradykinin receptors. So this probably opens the blood vessels and makes leaky blood vessels. So if ACE2 is knocked out, this pathway gets dominant and it becomes worse. Now the SARS coronavirus uses ACE2 to enter our cells, being the critical receptor, as I showed you, and at the same time downregulates ACE2. And of course, if ACE2 is downregulated and there's lung injury, Ang2 can, in addition to the virus, drive lung pathology. So we believe what we discovered was actually a molecular explanation why the SARS virus became a killer virus, because it SARS coronavirus spike protein binds to ACE2. ACE2 is the critical receptor for it. And by binding to it, it actually downregulates ACE2 expression, enhancing the severity of acute lung injury, ARDS. And ACE2 is critical to protect against severe lung injury. So based on all of this, so we thought if ACE2 is lost, so maybe like an enzyme therapy, we could actually make a recombinant human form of ACE2 and see if this would alleviate the severity of lung injury. So this is what it is, an acid injury. This is our controls. This is actually elastin. So this is a measure of lung function. So severely impaired lung function. And here we give a bolus in infusion of ACE2 and we can stabilize the disease. So indeed, the enzyme function of ACE2 plays a critical and important role. So to put this all together, what I'm telling you, and of course I have a very ACE2-centered view, there are other systems which are very important, the immune system, of course, thrombotic systems, other systems. But in essence, ACE2 sits in our nose and our throat. This is where the virus lands. This is probably what makes these new virus variants more dangerous and can infect more kids, because kids probably have less ACE2. But if you need less viral particle for infection because they have high affinity for ACE2, then of course you can infect many more people. This is probably what's happened to the British, the Brazilian and the South African variant. So in most people, some people might not even realize they get it, probably can still pass it on being asymptomatic. Some people might get the common cold and that's it. But in some people, probably around 10%, it gets into the lung, into this particular type 2 alveolar cells, which also make surfactants. So this is why the lung is collapsing. That's very typical pneumonia, very deep pneumonia, very different from influenza. And of course, from there, the virus can spill out into the heart and in the blood vessels. I showed you the blood vessels can be directly infected, into the brain, into the liver, into the kidneys, into the intestine. So early on, COVID-19 is a lung disease, a disease of the a common cold disease, but in some patients, unfortunately, can spread in multiple tissues and lead to very severe sequelae and of course, with unfortunately high death rates in people with comorbidities, especially older people. So ACE2 can explain a lot. The virus entry, the first attachment of the virus, the spread of the virus, and the pathologies and what we see in multiple tissues. Again, it's not the only one, but we actually understand. And so these are the data of the patient. So day zero, this is where the treatment was started. So you can see in the red blob, there's a lot of angiotensin II. Then the treatment started, angiotensin II disappears. There's lots of angiotensin VII. The treatment is for 7 days. Lots of Ang-7 produced. There's less angiotensin II. Here day eight, then the treatment stops and angiotensin II increases again. So the first message is, the enzymatic function of ACE2 still works, even in the scenario of severe COVID-19. The second thing was great because actually the treatment starts here in the red arrow and stops with green arrow. It's actually twice a day IV infusion for 7 days. The inflammatory, the cytokines go down. So the cytokine storm goes down one season in this patient. This could be anecdotal, could have happened even without the drug. However, what was really important and was the second question we could answer is, it's nice to know that ACE2 binds to a spike protein at the virus, and this might neutralize it, but could it be that this actually diverts the immune system, so the immune system cannot recognize the virus properly anymore, and actually they cannot, and the patients don't build a proper immunity against the virus anymore. So we could test this in this one named patient. First, on the blue lines is actually virus load. So again, here's start of treatment, here's stop of treatment, and the virus load in the plasma, in the trachea, and the nasopharyngeal swabs actually went down, which is great to see that the virus disappears. But to be honest, to detect viruses, and I think many clinical trials experience this, is not so easy. So this could again have been anecdotal. By the way, the patient recovered and is now healthy and actually is at home now. However, this is the critical data, this green line. This is actually neutralizing antibodies against the virus. So also we treat the patient with ACE2, soluble ACE2. The patient developed high titers of antibodies neutralizing the virus. And this was critical. So we could answer two important questions. The enzyme still works, and when we use the treatment, there's still an induction of productive immunity, at least for antibody responses, which is, of course, very important for the safety profile of our trial.